generally seen as a competitor to destiny, you know. Like free will is this side, free will is on Russia's side, and you know, destiny is on America's side. You know, who will win the war, you know, Cold War? But it's not like that. They are never at war, actually. They are best friends. They are each other's creators, actually. Your free will create your future destiny.
Yeah.
Suppose you make bad decisions now. Suppose you decide that, okay, I will come and smoke a cigarette today. So now you are using your free will in a particular way. So then what happens? That will shape your destiny. You will become addicted very soon. Now, that destiny, suppose you have smoked 1,000 cigarettes. And now, 1,001 time, I come and tell you, oh, will you smoke today or will you not smoke today? So now you still have the free will, right, to say no. But will you be able to say no? It's very difficult because you have used your free will in the wrong way for 1,000 times. And now that has become your destiny, that whenever you see or you feel, you go and smoke. So free will,
you are used to it. Yeah.
So now it is like that. That has become like your destiny. Even though the free will is there, it has almost become like your destiny. Because now your free will has created that destiny. So this means what we do now will decide our future. So free will and destiny are never at war. And the malefics give us challenges, or the malefics, they don't give us challenges. They represent our challenges because in the past, we have used our free will in not very good ways. And that is why we face challenges. So sometimes people say, oh, I was fired from job because, you know, my Saturn got activated. I mean, Saturn is a poor fellow sitting millions of miles away. Why? What will he get by firing you? I mean, you are not, your boss is not going to give Saturn some money now. Please fire him. What Saturn has to do with your job? He's simply reflecting maybe your irresponsibility in your job or anything like that, because of which you lost the job or some mistakes you did. So the point is, if we want to benefit ourselves from the malefics, then we must use our free will in a proper way. And especially for planets like Saturn, because Saturn is the most malefic among the three. Saturn is undoubtedly the most malefic. Malefic means he gives the most difficult situations, forcing you to become independent. So that's the game of Saturn and Mars. You know, Saturn makes you like Mars. And many times people experience, like sometimes somebody asked me that, can you give me one shortcut to judge Saturn? How do you know how is Saturn placed? So it's a very easy way. It's like rocket way, super shortcut to judge how is your Saturn. Whenever you are under Saturn's Antardasha or Mahadasha or even Pratyantara, does something happen in your life because of which you feel like crying? It can be anything happening that time or something of the past, anything it can. Does it happen? If yes, then your Saturn is showing serious challenges. And if no, then your Saturn is well placed. Because that is his highest punishment. That what is that? That's the 8th house, and he's the Karaka for the 8th house. And 8th house is originally Scorpio, where moon gets debilitated. So 8th house, as I made a video on 8th house, I said 8th house is like the graveyard. Smashan Ghat, it means as if somebody has died. Or it means something which you are so attached is not there with you anymore. It's taken away from you. So what happens? Your tears are dropping from your eyes, and you are overwhelmed. You cannot accept the fact that you have lost that thing. And when you cannot accept that, what happens? You know, you start crying. So that is a very easy way to check how Saturn is placed. And of course, now if you're...
I want to ask you one question, Bhavaji.
Yes.
So, as you said that Saturn and Antardasha and Maharasha will tell us how Saturn is placed. So suppose that someone is under Jupiter, Mahadasha and Saturn Antardasha. So Jupiter being a great benefic, and instead of that, if someone is under Ketu, Mahadasha and Saturn Antardasha, so the results can be different, right? Like the way you gave the
results
example.
Results can be different, and this point which I said was irrespective of any Dasha or any Lagna also. Because if you put Lagna, then all this fancy things will come, na? Yog Kara,
Lordship,
or Naya,
respective. Sign placement.
No Lagna, nothing. Just check. And you will always realize that, see, that's the beauty, na? Saturn, see, Saturn, his job is fixed. He wants to make you independent. But now, he may make you independent in thousands of matters. There are thousands of things in this world. So that will depend on his placement and the Lordship. It's very simple. So essentially, Saturn is never ever bad for any house. Mm-hmm. I'm very careful with my words. I didn't say it's not bad for the household. I said never bad for the houses which he lords or where he's sitting. Now suppose that same Saturn is sitting in your 8th house. Then the rains may be more. Because now he's already the Karaka, and it's like, you know, it's like a double blow which you are facing. Which means now that means externally also your situations have become so intense that you are not able to handle that and become independent. So another way to check your Saturn is, one thing I said, do you feel like crying during Saturn? And the other way, that's a bit long, but that is that is something which you will realize at the end of the Dasha.
Okay.
You see, when your Saturn period started, let's not go to Antara Dasha, just take Pratyantara. Just check day one of the Pratyantara. For that, you have to have right Ayanamshas in the calculation, or you can take some estimate 1 week here, there. Just check the task which was given to you. Could you achieve it or not now? By the end of Saturn, could you achieve it? Yes or no? If you could, then your Saturn is well placed. Or now suppose two things happen. You felt like crying, but at the end you completed the task. So suppose you are working, let's take a typical work scenario. Now your Saturn Pratyantara starts, and then your boss, you know, throws, you know, some mountains on you, and then you are feeling like crying. Oh God, I will die. But then suppose by the end of the Pratyantara, maybe 2 months, 3 months, or 4 months at max, 4 or 5 months, maybe if long planets, Venus, Saturn, something else, you have achieved the target. Then that means your Saturn is having the ability to cope up with the challenge and make you independent.
True.
If now suppose you could not do it, then what is the next Dasha that comes after Saturn? That's Mercury. So then in Mercury is benefic. He will not make you independent. That's not Mercury's job. Then what he will do? You will go on running around people. Hey, can you help me? Can you do this? And then what they will do? They may help you. Because Mercury is a benefic. It is his job that he has to give you some help from the society. So then your friends will help you. If Mercury is the 7th Lord, your spouse will help you. But of course, now if Mercury as the 7th Lord is sitting in the 12th house, it will seem as if your spouse is helping you, but that will end you in more trouble later on. So this is how you have to study, you know. So these are two ways you can check very quickly about Saturn. And about Rahu, the easiest, quickest, and the most super short way to check Rahu. You know? It's like, imagine you never knew astrology, but you knew there is something like Rahu Dasha or Pratyantara or Antar Dasha. Just check, have you been cheated in Rahu? This thing, nothing else. Did somebody speak and, in Hindi they say, na, zuban se mukar jana. Why zuban se mukar jana? Because in Ramayan there is a famous saying, you know, that Raghukula Rita Sada Chaliai, Prana Jai Vachan Na Jai. Which means if the Raghuvanshis have given a word, they will either die or they will never let it go in vain. And that's what happened. Dasarath Maharaj gave a boon to Kaikeyi that whenever you ask two things, I will fulfill it. And that is why he had to say to Ram that, you know, go to the forest, and Bharat had to be put as the king, because that's what Kaikeyi demanded. So what is this going back? You know, Rahu is retrograde on this.
Yeah.
And another way to check Rahu in our chart is, irrespective of Dasha, or this is not related to Rahu, Dasha or Pratyantar Antar Dasha, any irrespective of whatever is going on in your life, does it happen that you say and you don't do it, or you step back? Arey, bola tha, sorry, nahi ho paya. Are you that kind of a person? Now it's very subtle. You may not realize that you are doing it. You can check yourself. Did it happen that it can be anything? Replying to somebody in a mail. Oh yeah, I will reply. Oh yeah, I will see you. Oh yeah, yeah, I will come. Oh yeah, yeah, I will do it. Oh yeah, yeah, we will go. But then, now suppose if Jupiter is well placed, when you are coming back, then he will apologize. Oh, I am so sorry. I could not do it. But if Jupiter is also badly placed, then he will make stories. So the inability to fulfill your word, that comes from Rahu. And if somebody feels that I am like that person, that's how I am behaving, and to the degree we are behaving like that, to that degree our Rahu is not helping us, or we have not
evolved that much.
Yes, we have not evolved with Rahu, which means that we have to work on ourselves more. And about Ketu. Ketu's way, there's a very easy way to check Ketu also. And this is maybe the most simplest way we can check Ketu. We just need to check that, do we feel headless about life in general? Mm-hmm. And when I say life, I necessarily don't mean any particular area. Of course, that may be more specific to which houses Ketu, where Ketu is placed.
Yeah.
In general, when you are just sitting in meditation, you can ask yourself, do you think you have a head? Because Ketu is headless, right? So if you have a head, it's like you are not Ketu. It's like saying you are not Ketu, which means you are not feeling as if Ketu's influence is there in your life. So we can ask ourselves this question, that do we feel that we are more headless, we are confused, we don't know what to do. That can manifest at different levels, materially, spiritually. And dashas can also modify, alter. Or in Ketu Dasha, you can check, do you feel headless, confused? If yes, then Ketu has not evolved. And you have to evolve Ketu more and more. Or you have to evolve yourself through Ketu, not that you evolve Ketu.
Exactly. That is what I was going to say. But I think these are the...
Yeah, you are about to ask a question, if I remember. Please go on.
Yeah. So, are you, like, according to you, these malefics are an asset in Kali Yuga?
Very good question. So, malefics, see, in Kali Yuga, what has happened is the benefics, their importance has reduced. And because of that, happiness has gone down. And now when I say malefics here, I would not refer to these three malefics only. Here I would refer to the other gang, you know, the Suras and yes, the Asuras. They're two different gangs. So nowadays, if you see, like Jupiter, for example, he's in the gang of the Suras, you know, the Devatas. So his duty is to give you happiness, the second house of family, the fifth house of children, or love or creativity or whatever you call, and ninth house of divine knowledge, divine wisdom, and 11th house give you some fulfillment at a material level, That's what the 11th house is. It's not necessarily monetary gains. The 11th house is a very peculiar house. People think it's the house of monetary gains. Actually, it is not. It represents gain of all the other houses. That is why it is also the house of charity. Because it also has to represent the gain of the 12th house. Now, that does not mean that the 11th is 11th from the 12th or 12th. I mean, actually, it's 12th from the 12th. But what I am saying is that it represents gain of any house in general. Because it is your gain ultimately, the gain of the lagna. And whatever the lagna wants, the 11th house fulfills. Not money always. Or not money only. So therefore, these four houses, they are the prime houses. And then sun, sun is the karaka for the lagna and the ninth. Sun is the karaka for these two houses. And if you see primarily the other, and moon, moon is karaka for the fourth house. And then primarily the other gang, the asuras, headed by Venus. Venus actually is Lord, is the karaka for the seventh house. And Mercury is the prime karaka for the 10th house. He is the primary karaka. Sun and Saturn are also karaks, but they are secondary. Most important is Mercury. And Saturn, we all know, Saturn is the karaka for the 6th, 8th and the 12th. So that means when we talk at a spiritual level in Kali Yuga, the strength of the suras have gone down. And the strength of the asuras have increased. So that means in Kali Yuga, actually, the planets Mercury and Venus, they also behave like malefics.
Yeah.
Now, not traditionally, as per definition. As per definition, now that's the fun part, you see. Now, traditionally, they are benefics. So they will make your surroundings easier. They will do that. That's their job. They don't want you to be independent. They want you to be interdependent. But in Kali Yuga, what happens? That interdependence also brings misery. It brings suffering. Because in the other yugas, what would happen was, like Satya Yuga. Why is the name Satya Yuga? Because the Sattva Guna is at its peak that time. Sattva Guna means everybody is all good. Nobody is thinking bad. I mean, in fact, it is said in Satya Yuga that even if you had a bad thought, it was punishable. It was by law you are punishable if you are having a bad thought. And it is said that if you would come in front of somebody and you had a bad thought for that person, the person would come to know. Now, which are the planets that represent Sattva Guna? One is Jupiter, other one is Sun and Moon. These three planets. So the power of these three planets have reduced. And the power of the other gang, the Asuras, they have, as Satyuga keeps progressing, the power of these three keeps going down. And in Kali Yuga, as Kali Yuga begins, they collapse. Almost. They start collapsing. And as Kali Yuga ends, 432,000 years, out of which 5,000 years have gone, they are fully finished. No benefits. And then that's in 12th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, the prediction is there that when there is dissension everywhere, when people have lost it, they have become totally crazy and Kali Yuga has ended, then Kalki, Vishnu takes avatar as Kalki and he only the ones who are taking the name of Vishnu is saved. Just imagine the level of that degradation at that time, that anybody who is just chanting the name of Vishnu, Kalki will spare him. Like he's like Yudhishthir that time. According to Kalki, you are a great person, you are very good. And then, of course, the sandalwood pulp will permeate the entire universe and Satyuga is restored. So, in Kali Yuga, what has happened is independence has started increasing. And that has made people more miserable. Like, one of the most frequently asked questions which I get is that, I am very lonely. So, what should I do? Can you give me some mantra for love?